Hey guys, today I wanted to have a brief, I always say brief and then it ends up being like 2 hours long, but I wanted to have kind of a foundational conversation about attachment theory because there's a particular aspect of it that I think we often leave out or get wrong, and that makes it really hard both to understand ourselves but also to understand other people. And until we get this part of attachment theory, until we really understand how it's working for us and why our strategies perpetuate themselves, even in situations where they seem to make no sense, we will continue to make no sense to ourselves, right? And I think that a lot of people who have attachment wounding, whether you are anxious, avoidant, or fearful avoidant, or anywhere in between, really struggle with this feeling of self-sabotage. Like, it can feel as though no matter what situation is presented to you, no matter which opportunities you seem to have for trusting people and forming healthy, close relationships, you find a way to mess them up. And a lot of people who are insecurely attached come to think of themselves as self-sabotaging. But I really don't think that that's the right word for what's going on. I do think that on a conscious level, it absolutely feels like that's what we're doing. But on an unconscious level, what we're actually doing is misreading the situation and applying a response that is highly adaptive in the context that we grew up in to a situation that that response isn't necessarily adaptive to. So the avoidant person might be surrounded by a lot of people who genuinely care about them, genuinely would be there for them if they were to open up and share what their challenges and struggles are and ask for help. And the avoidant person might even know this on a conscious level, right? They might be able to sit down and name you a list of 10 people who they are 100% sure would be there for them if they were to open up and be honest with them. However, there is this kind of primal freeze response that happens whenever they try to do that. That might feel like self-sabotage, right? And on the other end of the spectrum, we have the anxiously attached person who might find themselves in a loving, secure, warm, caring relationship one day and still find themselves feeling highly suspicious of their partner, finding themselves picking fights out of nowhere and not even understanding why they're doing it, and continuously monitoring the relationship for any slight sign or signal that something might be off. And then in the middle of this spectrum, right, we have the fearful avoidant who might actually get triggered by things going well. So the happier and calmer and more connected the relationship becomes, the more and more they start to feel restless and frantic and like they want out of it, but they don't understand why. And all of this on the surface looks like self-sabotage, right? You have a good thing and you ruin it. But it's actually not self-sabotage. It is a misread of the situation. And in any of these three scenarios, the skills that are being applied by the avoidant, anxious, or fearful avoidant individual are all skills that are highly adaptive in an unsafe environment. The only problem is that they're not realizing that they are actually in a safe environment now. So what it is an assessment error, but if you call it self-sabotage, you're not necessarily pinpointing the right problem. It's not necessarily that you're afraid of being happy or that you're just someone who can't trust other people. It's that you haven't learned how to recognize when a situation is safe and when a situation is unsafe. A secure person in any of those safe environments will be able to recognize the environment is safe and be both warm and open with people, but also have a healthy sense of independence and allow the people around them to enjoy a healthy sense of independence. However, if you put a secure person in an unsafe situation, physically or emotionally, they're going to have to learn new skills to adapt. And the skills that they would have to learn would be the skills that the anxious and avoidant people naturally employ because they grew up in environments that were physically and or emotionally unsafe. Okay, so it's not that your brain is broken as an insecurely attached person. It's not that you're crazy and that secure people are sane. It's that you are adapted to a different environment naturally than secure people are adapted to. They adapted healthily and properly to safety, and you adapted healthily and properly to danger. The problem is you never learn the skills for surviving and thriving in safety. So let's examine this through the lens of a metaphor. I live on a giant park, and across the park from me is a grocery store where I regularly go to get my groceries. It's about a 20-30 minute walk. And this park is super safe. It's like the number one place people go to walk their dogs or like take their babies for walks in strollers. It's like if you had a children's book and you were trying to paint the picture of like an idyllic, safe, happy park, this is what you would get. So if I were to tell you, I am terrified of walking through that park, I absolutely will not cross the route to get my groceries. I will happily spend an extra hour walking all the way around it instead because I don't believe the park is safe. You would probably think that I was being a little bit neurotic or overly suspicious or something was wrong with my reasoning, right? But what if I told you that I didn't want to walk through the park by myself at 3 a.m. instead of 3 p.m.? that would probably be a lot more agreeable to most people. A lot more people would understand, like, yeah, I wouldn't walk through a dark park at 3 a.m. by myself either. Because in that situation, the exact same stimuli, the park, is functioning under different principles where there's added danger. So now my fear of the park is rational, right? Depending on the context, the same fear can be either rational or irrational. Now let's say that I have no ability to tell time. For whatever reason, I cannot tell when it is 3 a.m. and when it is 3 p.m. Now, is it starting to make a little bit more sense that I might always avoid the park? Yeah, because it might be safe if it's 3 p.m., but I don't know whether it's 3 p.m. or 3 a.m., so I'm going to be cautious and I'm going to take the long way around because I haven't figured out ways to tell daytime from nighttime. And this is kind of what it's like being insecurely attached. You're aware that there are dangerous interpersonal situations and safe interpersonal situations, but you never really develop the skills to pinpoint which one is which. And depending on your attachment strategy, you might accidentally move towards danger way too often, or err too far on the side of caution and avoid safe situations because you just don't know what's safe and what's dangerous. So you might have insecurely attached people walking directly into dysfunctional relationships time and time and time again, because they weren't able to notice the warning signs early on that other people learn to notice, right? They thought it was 3 p.m. when really it was 3 a.m. Or on the other side of things, you can have an attachment wound that leads you to believe it is always 3 a.m. when really it's 3 p.m. So you believe you're unsafe when you're actually safe. And it gets even more complicated than this, okay? So polyvagal theory, which is becoming increasingly popular, talks a lot about a concept called neuroception. So what that means is that we are constantly taking in information via our senses about what's safe and unsafe in our environment. And our body is already reacting to what we think is safe or unsafe before our conscious mind has a say. So let's say that I grew up in a war zone. And the rustling of bushes often indicated that someone was hiding in those bushes and my life was in danger. Now when I walk through my park, even if it's 3 p.m., the second I hear a rustle in the bushes, it might be a squirrel. But before I have the time to consciously think that's a squirrel, my body is already on high alert, right? And when our bodies are triggered like that, it's very hard to convince them consciously to calm down because they are trying to protect us. And there are absolutely lots of things we can learn to do to downregulate when we're in fight or flight mode, or to upregulate if we're in freeze or shutdown mode. But often it's the body response that comes first, right? And when we have that body signal of danger, what our mind naturally does is it looks for reasons to justify that feeling. So if I'm in the park, unless I'm hyper aware of my own responses, I'm probably not going to register, I thought that rustling in the bushes was an enemy, but really it's a squirrel. What I'm gonna register is just, I feel scared all of a sudden. Why is that? I might look around and go, okay, is someone following me? Am I picking up on a kind of sketchy situation, but I don't know how to pinpoint it? And probably I'm not going to take my chances and reason with myself. I'm just going to book it out of the park. And again, this is kind of what happens in insecurely attached relationships, right? A perfectly benign scenario within your current relationship could be a scenario that in the past was actually quite dangerous. So a good example of this is, let's say you have an anxious attachment style. When anxiously attached children are very young, they learn to get their caregiver's attention by exaggerating their negative feelings because their caregivers were intermittently responsive, which means that sometimes they would pick up their child and be very warm and caring, but often the child had to work very hard to get their parents' attention. So in an early environment, it's highly adaptive for an anxiously attached child to exaggerate displays of negative emotion and make a very big deal out of their negative feelings. And what's interesting is that when an anxiously attached baby is making a big show out of their feelings, and the parent does go and pick the baby up and soothe it, it often becomes even more inconsolable because it believes that, okay, now I've got mom or dad's attention, right? And the only way I'm gonna keep it is if I continue to cry. They're afraid that if the negative emotion goes away, their parent will once again lose interest in attending to them, so they have to keep it going. Now, as an adult, your biological response might be to do the same thing with a partner, right? So if you and your partner are fighting and you're getting all of this focused attention and they're really attending to you, and then all of a sudden a resolution point kind of emerges where you realize the fight could end here, we could be done. Your entire body might be screaming, no, 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 if you stop the fight, it means just like your mom would put you back down when you stopped crying, your partner is gonna stop paying attention to you if you stop fighting. So your brain might automatically start scanning for things to continue to be angry about without you even knowing that you're doing that, right? That's a very, very common theme in anxious attachment, and it often leaves the anxiously attached person with this feeling of, I don't even know why I was fighting like that. I don't even know why I was angry. There can be almost this kind of amnesia that happens after a fight, where it feels confusing even to the person instigating the fight because they weren't consciously aware of that trigger that went off, right? First they had a body response, then their brain just made something up to go with it. Similar to that situation where you're walking through the park and suddenly your body's on alert, you might not even have noticed that you heard the rustling in the bushes. You just know I'm scared and I don't know why. And that's exactly what it feels like when you're having an emotional flashback from childhood in an adult attachment relationship. Suddenly I'm just angry or distant or feel desperate and I don't know why. And we can also look at this from an avoidant perspective, right? Let's say your partner comes over one day and they're giving you lots of positive attention and you're really connected and you feel close to them. And then all of a sudden you get this huge feeling of disgust that just overwhelms you and you don't want to look at your partner. You don't want to be anywhere near them. You feel embarrassed that you're even with them and you almost desperately need them to go away and leave you alone. Of course, in the moment, this might feel like it makes no sense, and your brain is going to come up with a reason why that happened, right? It's going to go, oh, well, we're just not well matched in this way. It's going to find things to twist and misinterpret to support the feeling that you have in your body of disgust and repulsion. However, what might actually be happening is that early on in life, you were classically conditioned to see displays of closeness through the lens of disgust, because your parents may have subtly responded to you with disgust anytime you showed a sense of vulnerability or a need for intimacy. And as a child, avoiding closeness and intimacy was highly adaptive because you learned certain displays of emotion equal rejection from my caregiver. So anytime you felt a desire for closeness and comfort as a child, your body kind of panicked and went, okay, time to self-isolate so no one notices that I'm having this response, because if my parents see it, they're going to express contempt and disgust towards me and I'm going to be abandoned. So this person who is just being a perfectly lovely and caring partner to you actually feels like a threat to you on a physical level. But you might not process that consciously. All your conscious mind comes up with is that classically conditioned response of intimacy, vulnerability, and connection. Ugh, disgusting, get it away. That was highly adaptive for you as a child because it allowed you to conform to your parents' worldview and get care and connection with them through other means. So, what is the point of all this? The point of all of this is that your attachment responses are not as mysterious as you might think they are, right? I think a lot of us go into attachment theory feeling like I'm insane, I have all of these responses that make no sense, and it actually gets a lot easier to work with your responses once you're able to put them into context and understand how they once worked for you. It's only when we're conscious about why we developed the strategies we developed that we're able to understand where they do and don't apply on a conscious level. Is it always going to be possible to perfectly contextualize our responses like this? No. But if we can learn to break down these kind of pivotal moments to what may have happened here that triggered this, we can start working with what the problem actually is, right? If we're calling it self-sabotage, we're not working with the real problem, because our bodies and our minds are not trying to sabotage us. They're actually trying to protect us in the only way that they know how. So I think that a lot of us have this kind of fantasy about attachment healing, where it's kind of like, okay, once I fix my attachment style, then all of my relationships are magically going to become wonderful and I'm going to only have healthy interactions from here on out. No, there will still always be danger. The only thing that's going to change is you're going to be able to tell, is it 3 p.m. or is it 3 a.m.? So when you are in a safe and secure relationship, you're going to be able to respond to it safely and securely. However, in relationship with other insecurely attached people, you will get eaten alive if you try to use a secure response. It's like saying, if I get really good at telling time, then I'm going to be able to walk through the park at 3 a.m. and have nothing bad happen to me. No. If you get really good at telling time, all that's going to happen is you're going to be able to notice when it's 3 a.m. and not a good time to walk through the park. And you're going to start walking through the park only at 3 p.m., right? Danger does not go away, and your unhealthy, insecure attachment strategies are still going to be the only thing that works in relationship with unhealthy, insecure people. The difference is that you won't want those relationships as much, because you'll be aware there is a thing called 3 p.m. There is a thing called secure relationships, and now that I know how to tell when that's the case, I can choose those over these unsafe, dangerous situations or people. People who are raised secure don't naturally have good skills for navigating unsafe, dangerous situations. They just know how to notice them and avoid them in a way that you, as an insecurely attached person, probably don't, because you grew up in an unsafe situation. So you learn that that was the norm. And as an adult, when an unsafe or insecure situation or relationship presents itself to you, you're more likely to go, yeah, that's normal, and then walk directly into it in a situation where a secure person would walk away from it. So if there's anything that I hope you guys take away from this video, it is quite simply that you are not crazy for having the attachment responses that you're having. You are not self-sabotaging. You are doing the best you can to apply the strategies that once worked very well for you to a situation that you have not yet developed the skills to recognize as different. Earning secure attachment does not mean suddenly functioning really well in unsafe situations. It just means being able to recognize what's unsafe and not choose that. And then when you are in a safe situation, you'll be able to recognize that as safe and choose to engage in it. And the kind of booby prize of being insecurely attached is that if you earn security, you kind of have an advantage over both insecurely attached people and people who've always been securely attached who were raised that way, because you know how to navigate both safe and unsafe environments. So if you ever accidentally find yourself in the park at 3 a.m., you know what to do, but you also know how to tell time and how to make sure that for the most part, you're only walking through that park in daylight. So there's lots of hope. You are not crazy. You don't hate yourself. You're not trying to ruin your own life. Your body is doing the best it can to protect you based on the environment you grew up in, right? Instead of getting mad at yourself when something about your own behavior doesn't make sense, get curious about why. Get curious about what context that thing might be adaptive in. And that's going to be incredibly helpful on your route to healing your attachment style, which we are going to talk more about in future videos. I just felt like this was an important foundational one to lay down before we start talking about how to do the work, because we have to understand that we are not our own worst enemy. All right, let me know where you guys are in this process. If you have done any work on your attachment style, if you are still struggling to figure out what your style is and how you show up, or if you are well down the road, and you're at least able to tell, okay, the sun is up or not, if not the specific time of day. Also tell me if that metaphor made sense to you guys. It made a lot of sense in my brain, but I don't always know how well things translate. Anyway, any questions, drop them in the comments. I love you guys. I hope you're taking care of yourselves, and I will see you back here again soon.